Mark chapter 2, verse 1. When he had come back to Capernaum several days afterward, it was heard that he was at home, and many were gathered together so that there was no longer room, not even near the door, and he was speaking the word to them. And they came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. Being unable to get to him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him, and when they had dug an opening, they let down the pallet on which the paralytic was lying. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." But some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, "Why does this man speak that way? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" They didn't know they were right. Verse 8, immediately Jesus, aware in his spirit that they were reasoning that way within themselves, said to them, "Why are you reasoning about these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up and pick up your pallet and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, get up, pick up your pallet, and go home." And he got up and immediately picked up the pallet and went out in the sight of everyone, so that they were all amazed and were glorifying God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." That's what it looks like when Jesus is in the house. That's what it looks like when Jesus is in the house. You will experience things that you have never seen before. And it'll move you off that cold, dead center spot of your religion. And there'll be a warmth and a fire with the relationship of the, literally the manifestation of the presence of Jesus that will impact everything in your life. It's not just a Sunday morning experience. It literally informs every thought that you have from that moment forward. That's the difference in religion and a relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Who is this Mark that's writing? Well, he's called sometimes John Mark. You probably already know that. We only have about 10 verses in all of the New Testament that reference Mark. There's not a lot that we're given about him. Some people argue, based on what Paul said to the church at Corinth, that Mark would have been the cousin to Barnabas. Barnabas, that encourager. Others would say he's the nephew, actually, of Barnabas. I'm not sure which scriptures they use. I'm not saying they're not there. I've just not read them yet. I'm sure some of you will point that out to me soon. So we know that he was at least related to Barnabas. And Mark writes from a little different perspective, because we're in the second chapter of Mark already here. That's obvious this morning. And you notice Mark does not give a whole lot of the genealogy. He doesn't give a whole lot of background. He just jumps right in with Jesus. Now, most scholars concur that Mark was really writing for Peter. Peter, that rugged fisherman, maybe not the best writer in the world, even under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And so Mark is writing from at least Peter's perspective. And he jumps right in with the emphasis being on Jesus. It's as though God tells Mark, "Look, turn the spotlight on Jesus. And let's show the world who Jesus is." And of course, if you take it from Peter's perspective, boy, it makes all the more sense knowing his personality. So this morning, just very quickly, I want to unpack for us all, based on God's word, what does it look like when Jesus is in the house? How would we know? I mean, what kinds of things could we look for if Jesus is truly in the house? So let's jump right in. Here it is. Number one, everyone is engaged. When Jesus is in the house, everyone is engaged. There's nobody he ignores. There's nobody he's unconcerned about. There's no one that he just says, "You're too far gone. I can't even do anything in your life." When Jesus is in the house, notice everyone is engaged. Back to verse 2. And many were gathered together so that there was no longer room, not even near the door. And he was speaking the word to them. I love Luke's version of this, chapter 5, verse 17. I've actually got it on the screen for you. It's a little bit different. He says, on one of those days while he was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there who had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and also from Jerusalem. And the Lord's power to heal, look at that, the Lord's power to heal was in him. Praise God, the power to heal is always there, but quite often it was based on the faith of the people. Were they responsive? Was it a time to heal? And this was one of those times where there was a responsiveness. It was the time for the Lord to heal. That was that manifest presence of God moving in their midst in these moments. But I pointed out the Luke version of this because notice it sort of opens up how many people were there. The Bible says there were Pharisees there. The word Pharisee means separated ones. They were some of the religious leadership of the day. They were the good group in some senses in that they believed in the resurrection. They believed in life after death. There were other groups like the Sadducees who didn't believe in some of those same things. He also says that there were scribes. Mark's version says there were scribes there. These were the ones who actually were those who would write down. They were the Jewish recorders of the law, if you will. They would later become the theologians in the Jewish faith. There were teachers. That word most commonly is just rabbis. Those who actually taught the law. And then there were just any variety of common people. People like you and I maybe wouldn't have fallen into any of those categories. And yet the scripture indicates to us that he engaged everyone. He was teaching them all. He was pouring himself into everyone. I hope that encourages you this morning because I believe that Jesus is in the house. And I believe today he is desiring to engage every person here this morning. And so you have a choice to make. Will you leave here saying, man, I experienced the presence of Jesus today. He was talking and I opened my ears. I listened to him this morning. I've heard from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords today. And you know, often I think we hesitate to share Christ because of what I would call observation and predisposition. I think sometimes we look at some people and we say, well, you know what, I can't talk about the things of God. They won't be open to them. That person, you know, I know that their hearts are not open. And Christ, he didn't fool with that garbage. He just spoke to everybody. He engaged everybody. He threw the seed out and let the soil express its level of receptivity. Joshua Van Hall found a picture for me. I want to show you this picture. It's a group of religious leaders, and it's a variety of people all around the Pope, and they represent a variety of faiths. And there are some people in that group. Maybe for you, every person is in that group. I'm pretty sure the guy that's kind of distant from the group is a Southern Baptist pastor, the guy that's way on the left. But the rest of these guys, I mean, they're all, because, you know, he didn't want to identify. But anyway, but I see all the rest of these guys, they're all together. And, you know, some of us would say, man, I would never talk to this person or that person or that person. Man, they're just so far out there. Can I tell you, Jesus loves every person in that photo. And he loves every person that's not in that photo. And Jesus, when he's in the house, he's going to engage everyone. Can I tell you something? You may not win everybody over to your argument and your defense of the gospel, but you can love everybody with the gospel. And Jesus did that. He engaged everyone. Look at verse 3 now. It says, and they came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men, and being unable to get to him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him, and when they had dug an opening, they let down the pallet on which the paralytic was lying. So when Jesus is in the house, he engages everyone. Look at this. Barriers are broken. You notice that? When Jesus is in the house, barriers are broken. You say, where do you get that? Well, look at this version of the Holman Christian Standard Bible of this very verse, verse 4 there. I've got it on the screen for you. It says, since they were not able to bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above where he was, and when they had broken through, do you see that? When they had broken through, they lowered the mat on which the paralytic was lying. Do you see the picture here? It's the barriers that were between the people and Jesus. They were broken down. When Jesus is in the house, he's not concerned with your barriers. He's not concerned with your issues in the sense of he looks at you and says, oh my goodness, there's too many layers there. We cannot connect. Jesus is about breaking down all barriers. Hear me. Christ will never compromise with what God has already said is sin. We won't redefine what sin is, no matter what our culture does, no matter what it says. But God came to love and redeem sinners. That's all of us in this room. We are all broken people. We are all dysfunctional at some level. We all have different issues. Some of us mask them really well. Some of us are just very boastful about it. And Christ came to break down those barriers. And by the way, you look at these four men. You gotta love these four dudes, right? I mean, these four guys that bring the paralyzed man to Jesus, I mean, they're absolutely amazing. We don't know who they are. The scripture doesn't identify them. They're just regular people like you and I. But obviously, they had adopted the philosophy of the Imagine Dragons, right? I mean, you remember? Whatever it takes. The line, in case you didn't hear it, is, because I love the adrenaline in my veins. Oh, that God could find a people. Oh, that God could find a church. That the adrenaline in their veins would pulsate when they began to engage everyone. When they begin to say, you know what? I'm going to break down the barriers. I'm going to do whatever it takes to get Jesus to people. That's what Jesus did. And that's what these four friends did, as they literally break down all the barriers to get their friend to Jesus. What are you doing to get people to Jesus? Six years ago today, I stood right here on this platform and preached in view of a call, and you voted to call me as your pastor 6 years ago today. Listen to this. No applause. Listen. 6 years ago today, I said, do not vote for me if you're not willing to do whatever it takes. You know, I didn't know that till this morning. I'd forgotten that date. I didn't plan this message around that. I already had this all planned. Or maybe I could say it this way. Maybe God already had it all planned. Challenge you today. Are you willing to adopt that philosophy? The second thing I was thinking about this. When Jesus is in the house, you do whatever it takes to get him to people. There's no doubt about that. And speaking of imagine, can you imagine there Jesus is teaching in that house, and he's teaching the word of God, and he's engaging the Pharisees and the scribes, and all of a sudden he's there teaching the word of God and things begin to fall from the ceiling. Can you imagine as that begins to take place? I mean, there he is, and all of a sudden the ceiling tiles begin to come down, and you see all these things, and yet I can't imagine that experience, right? I mean, I just can't even fathom what that might be like. I mean, I just can't even comprehend that. But that's what happened. And they were willing to do whatever. Listen, when Jesus is in the house, some people will be offended. When Jesus is in the house, some people will be offended. Why? Because Jesus rarely fits into our Orthodox religion. He rarely blends in with our cultural practices and biases. When Jesus is in the house, I'm telling you folks, he's going to shake things up. And when Jesus is in the house and somebody starts tearing the roof off to get their friends to Jesus, Jesus is going to love that. He's going to love that. Because remember, the Jesus that you've created may not look like the Jesus of the Bible. The Jesus in the Bible spit in people's eyes. The Jesus of the Bible, listen, the Jesus of the Bible, he rubs mud in people's eyes. The Jesus of the Bible said, I did not come to call those who are healthy, but those who are sick. That's the Jesus of the Bible. And that Jesus is frankly going to offend some people. Verse 5 said, and Jesus, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. But some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, why does this man speak that way? He's blaspheming. I don't like what I'm seeing. I don't like what I'm hearing. Some people are going to be offended when Jesus is in the house. A lot of you know that we started a church several years ago now we call the Trailhead. It meets on Wednesday nights, and frankly, it's not ever been what I thought it was going to be when God spoke into my heart a vision to begin that. It was designed to be a church for people who don't do Sunday. By the way, we live in a culture where people don't do Sunday. You're weirdos because you do Sunday. And it never really has. But now we have finally grown to where we are a church that the people who attend, 96% or so of the ones who are there relatively frequently, they're people who, it's their church. They don't even consider coming on Sunday. It's just foreign in their thought processes. And I can't tell you how many discussions we've had about what are we going to do with Trailhead. How many times Ethan and I have talked about it. Lord, what are we going to do? And every time we have that discussion the next Wednesday night, somebody sends him a message and says, man, that's just what I needed. Somebody sends me a message and says, thank you for doing Trailhead. I work on the weekends. I couldn't come on Sundays. It's my opportunity to worship, to engage. By the way, if you ever miss on Sunday, we by and large teach the same message on Wednesday. So you could come if you love Jesus and not miss Sunday and Wednesday. This Wednesday night was for me personally the greatest Trailhead worship we've had in almost 5 years of doing it. We had a young family come, and I won't give you a lot of details because I don't in any way want to embarrass them. But we had a young lady who acknowledged publicly that she was broken, and that she needed her higher power, which was God, to intervene in her life. And she shared with us openly, in fact, she stood and addressed the whole crowd, that she was supposed to be in AA, but instead, she felt like she needed to come to church. Can I tell you? She was wrecked Wednesday night. She addressed our crowd and used some words that I'm pretty confident some of the people in the room had never heard. And when I left Wednesday night, the Holy Spirit spoke deeply into my heart and said, those are the people that I love and that I want you to reach. Listen, the most beautiful part was when it was all over, most of the group began to move and leave as we do after prayer, as we close every Wednesday night. She addressed that group and she said, why are you leaving? She said that out loud. She said, did you just do your religious thing and now you're going back to your world? And I felt like God was using a broken person to speak to our people. To say, will you ever understand that this is not about you checking off your list, doing your church, and then hitting the cars? This is a group of people that God has called together in this city to make a difference in broken lives. It was an incredibly powerful and poignant moment. Some people will be offended. But when Jesus is in the house, Oh, this might be my favorite part. Sin is forgiven and healing is possible. When Jesus is in the house, sin is forgiven and healing is possible. Oh, he doesn't always heal. We know that, right? We see it in the scriptures. But we know it's possible because we know he has the power to heal. But we know this for sure, he can forgive sinners. That's what he did. That's why he went to the cross. Now listen, the culture that he was speaking to, look in verse 8. Immediately Jesus, aware in his spirit that they were reasoning that way within themselves, said to them, "Why are you reasoning about these things in your hearts?" Verse 9, "Which is easier, to say that the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and pick up your pallet and walk? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, get up, pick up your pallet, and go home." And I think the manuscripts must have been in error here. This is the only place I would say we blew it, because I'm pretty sure right after that, he said, "Now take that." I'm pretty sure that just somehow was dropped out of the ancient manuscript. It's got to be there. "Now take that." Verse 7 ended with, "Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Remember what he said? And again, he was correct. Now listen, in this culture, when these biblical events were that are historically accurately recorded, when those events were going down, everybody listening to him understood that everyone had an issue with sin. Everybody understood that. Nobody thought, "Well, I don't have sin. I'm not a sinner." What kind of crazy thinking is that? In that culture, everyone understood that they were sinners. Some didn't care. But they all understood. Everyone, they knew this. Everyone in that room would have known that they were headed to judgment without the intervention of God. Can I tell you, that's the kind of culture I grew up in. As you already know, most of you, if you're a guest, you know because of my accent. I'm a Southern boy, born in New Orleans, grew up in South Mississippi. And everybody I knew was well aware that they were sinners and they desperately needed God to intervene. But most of them thought they would do that just before they took their last breath in life. And that's the culture. I didn't have to convince anyone that they were desperate for a holy God to redeem them. That's not the world we live in now, is it? No one sees themselves as a sinner in need of God's mercy and God's grace, or at least rarely. So in that group, everybody knew it, but Lloyd Legalist just could not grasp that Jesus was God actually providing the answer for that sin. Lloyd Legalist was so hung up on his traditions, he was so hung up on what he knew and understood, and the biggie, what he had experienced prior to this, when Jesus shows up in the house, he didn't know what to do with it. I'm just going to leave that right there. When Jesus is in the house, everyone will be amazed and glorify God. When Jesus is in the house, everyone will be amazed and glorify God. Look in verse 11. "I say to you, get up, pick up your pallet and go home." Verse 12. "And he got up and immediately picked up the pallet and went out in the sight of everyone, so that they were all amazed and were glorifying God." You notice that word "all" there? It's the same word we see throughout the New Testament. All means all. They were all amazed and were glorifying God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." Oh, they had all seen religion. But today Jesus was in the house. And everything was different. His presence was so manifest. and sin was forgiven, and the physical power of healing was exhibited. I close quickly. Isn't there something in you that longs for this? And maybe you're so afraid, you're so scared, it seems so foreign to you, you're not even sure you want to acknowledge that, but really, isn't there something in you that longs for this? Isn't there something in you that hungers to see that kind of expression of Jesus truly being in the house? Don't you want something more than just an evangelical expression of faith? Don't you long to see Christ move in a way that it impacts people just like it did here in the Bible? Seems to me it's real simple. Get Jesus in the house. Number two, get people to Jesus. Well, I'm going to say it again, and this is where Satan has some of you trapped today. Theologically, you think this is almost heresy. And you say, what is he pushing us to? What are we trying to do here? Where are we going? I'm just trying to get Jesus in the house. Beyond some theological system where Jesus is allowed to come and move freely in our midst. And then in turn, we recognize that our calling is to be like those four friends. And whatever it takes, get people to Jesus. Father, we want you in this house. And we don't want to dictate to you what it's got to look like. God, I can't imagine what it must have been like when those roof tiles started falling. Old dried bushes breaking off. Maybe some dirt where they had packed it in there with the tiles. I don't know. What the people must have thought. God, maybe they wanted to fire the facilities people. I don't know what they were thinking. How could we let that happen? But God, I know that we're hungry for you. And I know there are people in this room that are broken, and we are surrounded by millions that are broken. And they need you. Help us to long for your presence as outlined in Scripture. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.